Hello, Rotarians. Hi, everybody. Welcome, guests, and big hello to Natasha. And in fact, I have met Natasha. I have been introduced to her before, and I met her. And let me touch upon that first before going into her qualifications. And I met her at Mohan Shani's house when we visited his house for Ganpati, and some of us were there. And Natasha was there also. And she came about as a very different person to me. And I wondered, how come, what is different about her? I mean, a person that was full of, service and gratitude and filled, and also a lot of empathy. And at the same time, not judgmental. And I also found that she is full of energy, and generally speaking, and these were like more in COVID times than now, and usually people are quite the opposite actually in COVID times, and their moods are different, and I found her really like overflowing with emotions. So I wondered how, and Mohan knows her, and he also told me that they are very close. She comes often, she stays close to his house, and they are like family members to each other. And great, and then I left, and then she gave me a book, which I read most of it. And this is the book. And imagine, she met us for the first time and gave us a book. I mean, I don't know if you can read the letters correctly. It says, mess to mesmerized. And that's her on the page. So coming back to what she does, and Natasha, is an internationally certified intuitive energy alchemist and transformational coach. She works on stress management techniques and methods. And she has had training in various faculties. She has done training in, neuro-linguistic programming, bar facilitator, mind map practitioner, energy work, studied under stalwarts like Tony Robbins, Robert Kiyosaki, also learned professional speaking from Sam Cawthorn of the Speakers Institute. And she also is an author. She's authored a couple of books, which she'll tell us about. And she basically spends her time and years helping people make massive changes in their lives and empowers them and allows them to achieve peace of mind and success in their personal and professional lives, and also in their relationships, finances, and health. So Natasha, we are also eager to listen to you, and we've been hoping to hear you ever since we met a couple of months back. And thank you for joining us, and over to Natasha.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much, Vicky, for the lovely introduction that you gave me. It was really heartwarming. So as today's topic is supercharge your life, so supercharge. See, we all of us face challenges and what is going on outside, external world. But you know what I believe is your internal world is a reflection of your external world. And what has COVID taught us, what is it? It has taught us that look within. People, I realized in COVID, there was so much mental depression, loneliness, domestic violence, because people, they are so used to focusing outside, going out for parties or movies, which is good. I'm not saying it's not good. But we focus so much that that's going to give us happiness and that's going to solve our issues. It's not going to happen. Now, let me tell you, these were all my achievements, but let me tell you a little bit about my personal story on why I got into this field 20 years back. I had a very happy family. Mohan uncle knows, we are like a father, mother, as every family would be, with two lovely children, like my brother, me, and my mom and my dad. But unfortunately, at the age of 7, I lost my mom of cancer. So it was very devastating, because as you all know, for a child to lose a parent is not easy. You know, we as it is, challenges are there in the outside world, and when you see such a big hit or when you're small, I guess you lose trust easily in people and lose trust in life. But I guess life went on. I had the most awesome father and brother, no complaints. But you know, the void always remained in my heart. I did everything, best of schooling, college, nothing was an issue for me. But you know, in my 20s, again, now here we are going to talk about the power of the mind. You know, I thought I'd overcome my mom's death, you know, in my 20s. But I still remember the first time when I went for this workshop on positive thinking. And in that workshop, we had meditations and a lot of affirmation techniques, you know, which helped me to improve my life for the better. So I still remember the first time when I sat and I meditated. It was hardly like a 10-15 minute meditation. You know, tons of tears came out of my eyes, and I, for the first time, I felt, you know, like a tons of tension off my head, and I felt so relaxed. And that's when I realized that I had not overcome my mom's death. You know, we think we overcome challenges and or certain situations that affect us very badly as a child or as we grow up, we think we've overcome it, but actually we have not. So when I do very deep-rooted energy techniques with people, or when I do one-to-one sessions or in my workshops, you know, I go very within, very deep. I work on the deep-rooted issue. And that's when, you know, when we clear those issues, people see a lot of changes in their life. So that's when I went deep and I realized that if in 15 minutes I can feel so good, what will happen when I start, you know, studying these techniques and seeing how things, you know, start shifting. Of course, I have worked for a bank for years. I've worked in events where I've dealt with a lot of celebrities and fashion shows and all. So this I was studying over the years, you know, these techniques, and it helped me to overcome my mom's death. And then my life started shifting in all areas, whether it's relationships, whether it's health. I had health issues also, whether it's financial issues. A lot of things started shifting in my life. And from that time, I determined that I will contribute to people's life and help them, you know, to shift their reality and see a difference in their life. So, okay, this is a little bit about my personal story. So my question to you, all of you, is, as I said, it's going to be more engaging session. How does everyone start their day? I want to know, when you get up in the morning, how do you start your day? So who would like to, you know, say? And again, there's no right, wrong, or, you know, there's no good, bad. I'm not going to judge anyone. It's just that I want to see how do you all start your day and go about it, because this is a very, very important aspect on, you know, working, transforming your life for the better. So would anyone like to unmute themselves and say?
I start my day with a small prayer.
Okay, awesome. That's really nice. That's a very good thing to start your day. And I'll tell you why I'm asking you the question, but I would like more engaging audience. And I would request you, if you could please put your cameras on, because I love to connect with people and engage with people. So a request, if you all could just put on your cameras. So anyone else? Gaurav, Razia, Barjor.
Well, I basically get up, and after doing the normal chores of brushing teeth, etc., etc., I get on to what's, at least now because of the COVID time, you know, one has to get some housework done. So I sort of, you know, start on that. And then I sort of gather my thoughts as to what I have to do during the day. It's generally one or two Zoom meetings, etc., etc. So I don't look at my phone till about, say, 9, 9.30. Awesome. And then I sort of start my day. And it sort of progresses through the day. That's it, basically. And sometimes when I have a little extra time, I sort of exercise a bit. It's not every day, but, you know, oftentimes a week. And then, of course, as the evening approaches, again, I go for a walk, whatever. So that's the basic way I start my day.
Okay, that's awesome. Anyone else? Mohan, uncle?
Natasha, my problem is that I normally sleep around 1 o'clock, 1 a.m. Okay. Whatever work is left over in the day, I complete at night. Right through my college school days, I have to study late. and get up late. And every morning when I get up, oh God, the morning has come now. Do I have to get up? Why not sleep a little bit more? Thank you.
Okay, cool. Okay, it all depends. Like they say, not early to bed, early to rise makes a person healthy, wealthy and wise. But of course, it depends upon people's work schedules, and some people work late, and some people, you know, see TV till late night, which I suggest, you know, don't unnecessarily waste your energy and mind on negative things. You know, it's very important. Why I'm asking this question is, you know, our mobiles nowadays, you know, they say we can live without people, but not without our mobiles. Because it's we are so dependent on it. But what I'm trying to say, when the mobile battery is low, what do? We charge, right? The mobile battery. If we don't charge our mobile battery, what's going to happen? The battery is going to die. So same thing is with our life, with our body. Like Barjor said, auntie said, like, you know, she said, we start our day with prayer. And Barjor says he looks at the chores and then he exercises. But, you know, what I suggest is start your day with anything you love. It could be prayer. It could be exercise. It could be meditation. It could be, you know, going for a walk in the morning. It could be listening to music. Why? Because when we start our day with what we love, you know, what is our energy? It's high. Right? We feel good about ourselves and our whole day will go very good. But if we start our day, for example, we are feeling low, or, you know, we've had a fight with someone, or we are thinking negative, then our whole day will not go good. So it's very important to be happy in the morning, because if you're happy in the morning and you have positive thoughts, your whole day will go very well. You know, so I suggest, and I'm not saying that you have to do meditation or you have to do prayer. If someone says, I want to go for a walk in the morning, you know, please do that. I remember one of my lectures, someone said when I was giving a lecture that I love to do martial arts, one of the students. So I said, wow, that's an awesome way. Why? Because when we exercise or when we do something we love, we increase the endorphins of our body. And when we increase the endorphins of our body, what happens? We feel good about ourselves and our whole day goes good. You must have noticed, you know, that if you have a fight with someone or we are irritated in the morning, don't you feel your whole day goes bad? You know, it, because the energy in the morning is not very good. So it's, if we are fighting or, you know, we feel low about ourselves. So it's very important how you start your day. Like, it's okay if you sleep late, you get up late, it's fine, but it's important to do some prayer or some meditation or something you love. It could be as simple as listening to music also, but it makes your mind relax. You know, as I said, you know, there are two minds. One is the conscious mind and one is the subconscious mind. Our conscious mind works only when we are awake. Okay, when we are working or when we are doing certain things, but our subconscious mind works 24/7. And you know, so when we see, when we see negativity news, or when we see TV, late night TV serials, or things which are negative or not very good for the mind, you know, when we sleep, it is working on our subconscious mind. You must have noticed if you see a scary movie in the night or something negative in the night, you get up very lethargic, low on energy. Why? Because our subconscious mind is continuously working. So I tell people, I suggest, you know, that when before sleeping, don't see anything negative, don't see the news, don't read newspaper which is negative. And you know what, I tell people that. I remember one of my best trainers, international trainers, had told me that when you get up in the morning, please don't read newspaper. Now you must be wondering, why is this girl saying don't read newspaper? We should know what's happening around the world and news. Yes, you should know what's happening. I'm not saying that don't read newspaper. I'm saying don't read newspaper in the morning. Why? What happens? Because when we get up in the morning and first thing open the newspaper, what is there? All negativity. You notice newspaper has nothing positive in it. So what are you feeding the mind? You're feeding the mind with all negative thoughts. This one has died. This COVID is happening. You know, it's only negative. So I suggest people, please don't do that. In the morning, do something you love. It's very, very important. You know, so what I do, and you know, if there are a lot of a very, very important technique by Harvard University, I suggest, it is suggested by them, is do journaling. You know, when you're feeling negative or when you're feeling low, take a journal and start writing down your negative thoughts. Once you write down your negative thoughts or anything, whatever you're feeling low, you can tear the paper and throw it, or you can burn the paper. Why? Because all that is in the mind, it's coming out on your pad, on your writing. So the more you clear your thoughts, the more you make your thoughts, you know, more positive by removing the negative thoughts, it really helps a lot. And I'm saying write. You notice, I'm not saying type. You know why I'm saying write? Because when we write, 10,000 neural pathways of our brains are functioning. And when we type, only 10 to 12 neural pathways of our brain are functioning. You notice in olden days, people could remember more things. People were more healthy because, you know, they were not eating a lot of online food, a lot of pizzas, a lot of cakes, which is really bad for health. You know, according to World Health Organization, 8 lakh people commit suicide every year. You know, it's shocking. And I have in the papers, it's come like India is on a 60% mental depression high. Was this heard 20 years back, 30 years back with our fathers and grandfathers? No, we never heard it because the stress levels are so high because we are seeing so much negative stuff, TV, mobiles, everything works more on the negative stuff. And the human mind loves negativity. You notice, you know, if a person is crying or feeling low, 10 people will go and console him and say, oh, you're feeling low. What happened? And, you know, even I'm feeling low. You know, let's go wallow in self-pity. But you notice if a person is laughing the whole day and if the person is just feeling good about themselves, what do we say? The person is mad. Ye pagal hai. Sara din kyun hans raha hai? You notice our mind. We cannot adjust to feeling good about ourselves. So when we do these very intensive techniques of writing down what, you know, what we are feeling the day, you'll automatically notice, oh, I'm feeling so negative. Let's be more aware of, you know, when you're feeling negative. So work on this technique. And it's not like a one day process. Like, as I said, you have to, like, I've been doing it for 20 years, like, you know, doing, because it's human nature. You know, there are challenges. We are bound to feel low. There are things happening outside, but the idea is to not be in the lowness, is to come out of it by doing journaling, you know. So in fact, every day before sleeping, you can do it because, you know, all, how did your day go? How did your work go? And, you know, so you can write down that. It's very, very effective, you know, and it is said, you know, by Albert Einstein, like, I call myself an intuitive energy alchemist. Why? Because there are two minds. One is the logical mind, which is the rational mind. And one is the intuitive mind, which is the wizard within. And when you do these meditations or these techniques, you're going way beyond the logical mind, which cannot fathom. And this is said by Albert Einstein, who was the most intelligent person in the world, because rational mind will only think of basic things, you know, which is very important. I'm not saying that don't work on that, but even more important is the intuitive mind, when we really go very deep within our lives and we see a lot of changes in our life, you know. Even, and even Thomson Edison or the most successful people said, you know, the thoughts, what we think is also energy. Everything on planet Earth is energy. You must have seen that Secret movie. You know, when you're thinking, if you're thinking more negative, then more negativity will come into your mind. You know, as the universe, I said, doesn't understand right, wrong, good, bad. It only understands energy. So, you know, if people are taking action, they are working 10, 15 hours a day. But if they are thinking, oh, you know, in spite of working so hard, I'm not making so much money, or I can't, you know, it's not possible for me to make so much money, or, you know, my relationships are messed up, I'm not happy in my life. What are you attracting? The universe is going to give you more of that. So then I don't believe in destiny and, you know, what's going to happen, because if your thinking only is wrong, if your thoughts, what are your vibrations you're giving to the universe? How do you expect good to come to your life? You know, I tell people, you know, a lot of people, we all listen to FM, right? 98.3, 94.3. So tell me something, if we are tuning into the frequency, okay, and we want to listen to 98.3, but we are not being able to tune into the frequency of 98.3, can we get the 98.3? Can we listen to the music? No. Same way with our thoughts. We want to achieve greater in our life, whether it's relationships, whether it's work, whether it's health, but our frequency is of no, yeah, it's not possible. Negative thinking will come. We'll start feeling low. Oh, you know, I'm working so hard. Oh, so much is happening in the corona outside world. It will happen to me. No. You have to stop thinking that way. You have to work on your mental muscle. And it's not an overnight game. It's not that one day you write the journal and tomorrow you're going to achieve success. As I said, it's a daily work in progress. The more you work on your inner self and your inner working on your thoughts and all, the more you start seeing changes in your life. So I suggest this, do this technique every day and see what shifts in your life. In fact, you all can try this technique right now. If any of you all are feeling like, how was your day yesterday? And you write it and tear it and you see humongous changes in your life. So try this technique. It is very effective. And another effective technique I suggest, which, you know, sometimes in office or workplaces, it's not possible to immediately, you know, start journaling when you're feeling negative, because sometimes people don't have that kind of time. So you can work on your thoughts. Anytime you're aware you're thinking negative, just say cancel, cancel, cancel thrice in your mind, not in front of anyone, because then people will think, you know, you're mad or what is this person doing. So anytime you're aware that, oh, I'm thinking negative, or you are with someone and your group of people, just say cancel, cancel, cancel thrice in the mind. It will negate your negative thoughts. This is also a very, very powerful technique. You know, in the mind, once you see it, you'll automatically see a shift of energy and you can see the difference in your life. You know, now let me tell you a story on how the power of mind works, whether it's a negative way or a positive way. Let's first work, you know, on the positive way. And this is a true story. You know, this person had cancer. When the doctor had detected cancer to this person, and they said the person is not going to, the doctor told her she's not going to live for long, and it's not going to, you won't survive, you know, few months you have left. So she said, okay, she went home and she didn't really take stress. She was seeing happy movies and she did happy things. She didn't think negative. She was more joyous. And of course, she was taking the medicines and what was required by the doctor, chemotherapy and all. And after 6 to 8 months, when the doctor went back, he was shocked. He couldn't believe that her cancer had actually resolved, because it's all her emotional turmoil. She did, of course, a lot of work on herself, meditation. She worked on the techniques. She tried not to think negative. If she felt low, she did something which made her energy high and happy. And the doctor actually said that the cancer had disappeared and she had no cancer. So you see, a mind can do that wonders and miracles in your life if you start thinking positive. But the work is, but she worked a lot on herself. Even her family members were shocked and a lot of shifts started happening in her life. This is the positive. Now, I'll tell you the negative aspect. This one person was there. He was working for a cold storage. You know, in cold storage, you go inside the storage and see if everything is okay and then you come out of it. So this man, unfortunately, when he went inside the cold storage, the door got locked and he was in the cold storage for full night. Now, you know, cold storage is like a person can obviously not live, because the storage is so high and it's all ice and everything inside. And when the people opened the door in the morning, he had died. But you know what was shocking? The shocking was they wondered why he died. Because the cold storage was not working properly and the temperature was not that high. But his mind was so negative and he said, oh, it's cold, it's cold, it's cold storage, I'm going to die, I'm going to die. And it was like that mind negativity and energy just ate up every cell of his body and he actually died. So you see what the same mind can do. It can give you miracles. At the same time, it can finish your life. Your life can end because of that. These are very, very powerful stories. So what is this story trying to tell us? It's finally up to us how we work on our daily thoughts. And I'm not saying it's going to be easy. It's a working on your mental muscle daily. Even sometimes I go into the zone, but the idea is to come out of it and say, okay, I'm not going to remain in the negative. I'm going to be more in the positive. So work on your thought pattern by doing journaling. Another thing I'll also give you a gift is space clearing. Sometimes, you know, there is a lot of negativity around. So what we can do is, you know, agarbatti, all of us must be taking agarbatti or dhoop. I've got it for you in case you all don't know what dhoop is. It's, you know, that Lakshmi dhoop. You know, you noticed only for Diwali we do these things. And you noticed the energy in Diwali. People are so happy. They are so joyous. And you've seen children, now they are so happy and joyous. But I'm saying, why only do it for Diwali? Do it daily. Do it when, if you have a lot of fights happening in the house or a lot of relationship issues, you can take dhoop or you can take agarbatti and 11 times. You know, you must have seen that infinity signal, 8. You know, 8 is infinity. So 11 times you do 8 with dhoop or, you know, your agarbatti or sage is also there. Where if you do it 11 times everywhere in your drawing room, bedroom, you will see the space clearing of the house is more at ease. You will see a lot of positivity happening in the house and the fights will reduce and you see a lot of space. Like, you know, a lot of people who come to my house, you know, if they have pain or they are stressed or they are not feeling good about themselves, you know, they just come to my house and they feel, you know what, Natasha, we feel so relaxed and so nice. And I know one lady who came just by coming to my house, only her pain disappeared. Because I work a lot on the spaces of the houses also. You know, because when we go very advanced level of energy, everything really speaks to you. As I said, everything on planet Earth is energy. I've done Vipassana meditations, you know, very like 7-8 times when, you know, we are naked eye can only see solidified structures. But when we go beyond, even the tables and chairs move. You know, the molecules of the tables and chairs move. So everything is energy. So if we think negative, what are you portraying across the electromagnetic field? It's all negativity and that's also going to go to your house. So try these techniques are very, very effective. Another very powerful technique I'll tell you is take rock salt. You know, put rock salt on all four corners of your house. And if you have maids coming, you know, they come and do like katka and all, you can put rock salt. Means you can tell the maid to put rock salt in the katke ka pani and sweep the house with rock salt. Because rock salt absorbs a lot of negativity. And a lot of you will start seeing, you know, shifts in your life. And also when you have bath, you know, like as we go outside, see, I'm very aware of energy on who contributes to me, who don't contribute to me. So when we go outside, you don't know what energy people are carrying with them. You must have noticed, you know, you might be very happy and joyful, but if you go for a death ceremony or if you or some person, you know, just drains your, sometimes you meet someone and that person just drains your energy down, that, you know, because obviously the person is carrying so much of emotional turmoil. I'm not saying the person is bad or anything, but sometimes people go through a lot of grief and emotional turmoil and they don't clear it. You know why I say energy clearing is very important? Because all of us have two IQs. One is the IQ, which is intellectual quotient, and one is the EQ, which is emotional quotient. Now, both are equally important. IQ, everyone's IQ is high because people are working, they are in businesses, they are in top companies, people are schooling. But you know, the issue happens when your emotional quotient is low. And people commit suicide when their emotional quotient is low, not when the IQ is low. So when I clear the abundance negative blocks of people, you know, then they start seeing a lot of shifts in their life. And so that's why it's important. So before you, like when you're having bath, you can take rock salt and put it in hot water and you can have bath of that or in the night before sleeping, because that will clear a lot of negativity. You know, a lot of energy clearing happens in the body when you do that. Again, I've been doing it since many years. It's not an overnight miracle, because when you go out, you're bound to attract, you know, what is happening outside. Like I tell people, you know, in a lot of my workshops, I tell people that you have bath every day. So people say, yes, of course we do. I said, don't have bath for 3 days. What will happen? So everyone says, no, ma'am, or no, we'll start smelling or we'll feel dirty. So I said, that is external clearing. What are you doing for your internal clearing? You know, so internal clearing is equally important. In fact, it's more important. Because you notice, you know, sometimes a person is physically fit. You must have heard the person was jogging and everything is very good, but the person died of heart attack. You know, he just fell flat. You must have heard, no? He just fell flat on the floor and he died on the spot. Or the person had gone for a holiday somewhere and they just collapsed. I've heard so many cases like that. Why? Because I'm not saying don't do physical fitness. Physical fitness is equally important. But the issues happen when your emotional quotient is low. Like for me also, my emotional quotient was very low, which I didn't even know. And why is coaching important? Because we don't know our blind spots. Sometimes we need help, you know, to people to show our blind spots. In fact, one of the most successful people have coaches. In fact, they have coaches in health, they have coaches in money, they have coaches in relationships, because they know that, you know, you have to, if you want to up your level, if you want to up your game, you have to come out of your comfort level and work on your inner self. And that's what a coach shows you. And that's what I do in my personal sessions. And these techniques, what I'm telling you, are very, very effective, but you have to have faith and keep doing it daily. You know, and not just say, oh, today I didn't do journaling, I'm tired, or, you know, I'm not. It's like, you know, it's like being the strict regime. Like if you want to become 100 kilos to 50 kilos, you can't say I'm going to have fried every day, or no, today I won't exercise, I'm tired. No. You know, you have to come out of your comfort level and work on these techniques. And another very powerful cleanser for the house is, you know, what is this? Camphor. It's very, very powerful. In Parsis, you know how important is fire, right? You all worship fire. It's very, very, why? Because all religious, even in temples, we have ghantis. And Muslims also, they have that dhoop, you know, that very powerful thing where it's all about smoke. Why? Because even religious thing knows that how powerful is fire. You know, so when you put camphor like in the house and burn it, it's a very, very powerful cleanser, and your whole house can be cleansed through camphor. I do it. In fact, I did it today also, because it's a very, very powerful space cleanser, which helps, you know, to clear the negativity of the house. Journaling, also music. Why I said music? Because music is also it's a de-stressor. You noticed on 22nd March, Modi had said clap, you know, when we clap throughout the house. And I also do. And if you don't have you know, music, or, you know, we can say even we do even utensils, like I do sound healing. So I like they say, you know, you should I don't know if this you can hear, but you can see the difference. All of you all just close your eyes for a few seconds and I'll play this for you and tell me how you feel. Okay, thank you so much. Didn't you all feel relaxed? Like by the sound, because I do sound healing also. Again, anything which makes you feel relaxed, you know, it's very important. And, you know, it is said by scientific research that Matthew Ricca is considered the happiest man in the world. And he was a scientist. And why? Because his prefrontal, because when we do meditations and these techniques, your prefrontal cortex, it relaxes, you know. The right and left brain of the prefrontal cortex relaxes. And then, you know, and that's how you feel happy. And when you feel happy, your productivity improves, your relationships are better. You know, Google, one of the biggest companies in the world, says the productivity of their employees improve when they do meditations. Now imagine abroad, if they are doing meditations, they are all copying all Indian techniques, and India is getting more, you know, abroad. We are trying to copy, like becoming the fast paced lifestyle by eating, you know, pizzas or having late nights and all. I'm not saying don't do it, but at least be aware of your body and health and mental capacities. These people, you can see all the top companies abroad are doing meditations. Why? means obviously they are seeing the difference, right? That's why they are doing it. In fact, Raymond Dalio, he's one of the biggest hedge fund managers in the world. Okay. And he says by doing meditations, he feels relaxed and his productivity of work improves. You know, and it is also proven 7,000 people meditated, 80% of the world terrorism reduced. Why? Because when your vibrations are of love and compassion, automatically the planet Earth will also be happy. And it's not about only yourself. It's about contributing to the society also. So when you be that vibration of love and compassion, automatically things will start shifting in your life. And hello, I'm not saying don't take action, don't come out of your comfort level. That is equally important. But what I'm trying to say, a balance of both is very important. Where I see nowadays, it's only taking action and emotionally people are still not, you know, stabilized and not happy. So that's when I say you have to, it has to be a combination of both emotional, both action and spiritual, you know, so that's very, very important to do these things. So I've given you, I think, a lot of techniques on how you can improve your life. And these are very, very easy techniques. And I would really love to hear from you that after applying these techniques, what shifted and how did your life improve and transform? And again, it's not like you do it today and it's going to happen. But the more you practice it, the more you start working on yourself and doing space clearing and seeing, you know, where I'm going wrong and how I can apply these techniques, you will only start seeing more shifts in your life. And as I said, I started seeing a lot of, you know, changes happening in my life. And in fact, today, like I had like more on Uncle Mo's, and thank you so much, he's helped me after my father had also died, and I had all again gone through that turmoil, and I've seen a lot of losses of loved ones. So I know, you know, a mind can get you are bound to feel low, you know, in life. As they say, you know, when you go to the hospital, they say a life is always ups and downs, right? It's only when you're straight line is when you're dead, right? So that's, I guess, a part of life. But the whole crux is to, you know, not be affected by what is happening outside and keep working on yourself. And as I said, it's a daily chore, like daily action taking will help you to improve your life for the better. So I guess, I hope I have supercharged everyone.
Thank you. Really, it's really very, very, very well put. And I realized when you use two or three terms as to how complicated you could have otherwise made it. But I think you put it very, very simply. I think you gave people a very, very good overview, a simple techniques, you know, about how to make things better. And as I mentioned to you, I think it's all in the mind. And it's very, very, very correct of you to say the outer must reflect the inner and, you know, vice versa. So while you may outwardly appear to be happy, inwardly, you may not. And then that's extremely important. I was quite impressed with what you mentioned about the small things in the house. I mean, I have heard about it, but I think you reinforced these are small things and, you know, one can easily do it. And if it helps, why not? If any of the members have any questions for her, please ask her now. Or any observations you'd like to make? Yeah, Mohan. Oh, he put, okay. Anybody would like to ask her a question?
I guess everyone is understood properly.
Yeah, I'm sure. I think Mohan is trying to say something, but I think he's on mute. Yeah. Mohan, you'd like to say something, Mohan?
Can you hear me, Natasha?
Yes, Mohan, yes. We can hear you.
My question is that everybody needs company in their life. And I know you're living alone by yourself. You have to run your house, servants. You had a servant, male servant for so many years. You have problems of management. Don't you feel lonely, alone, lost? Don't you feel you want people to hug you all the time and meet you socially and very comfortably?
Yeah, and actually, to be very honest, I don't feel lonely. and alone, because see, when you do these spiritual practices, Mohan uncle, you think way beyond what your body is, you know. So I'm not saying that I don't miss a physical presence, but I feel that this was my soul journey, and I'm not saying no, if I do find someone in the long run, I'm fine. But you know, it's better to be single then, because the amount of separations which are happening now, divorces, and so I know so many people who are unhappy. Just because, you know, you're married, that doesn't say that it gives you happiness. And again, happiness comes from within. And when I do work on relationships also, you know, first you have to be happy from within and then work on the outside. So I think I needed to heal myself first, which I wasn't happy from within. And maybe if I would have got married, I wouldn't have been happy, you know, because it's all about first being centered and happy from within and then looking out for someone, you know, who, and you know, this misconception people have that they are unhappy now and your partner is going to fill a void in your life. You know, I don't agree with that, because everyone is going to be with you for some time, right? As death, as you know, life is very uncertain. I still remember my father used to tell me this, you know, that I'm there and, you know, you will be okay now. But once, you know, I'm no more, you're going to feel lonely. And though, you know what I told him? What guarantee that he's going to live for long? There's no guarantee, right? I saw my mom when she died when I was 7. So there's no perfect guarantee that if I get married, he's going to be happily ever after and he's going to live with me for long. So I always had answers to life, which no one could give me. That's why I got into spirituality, to feel, okay, this is life and this is how to go about it. And I'm not saying that I didn't see someone, I didn't see guys for marriage. I did see. But sometimes, you know, right, that inner knowing whether it will really work out or whether it's going to, you know. And maybe what I wanted from marriage was very different than what I really wanted from life. And again, I'm not like saying that, no, I'm not going to. But I guess I take each day as it comes. And I believe in the higher source. And he knows what's best. So I feel that if someone has to be there, he will come, you know. And it will happen. But it's not that, you know, they say, you know, like that if you're very low and you're messed up and you see someone, you know, it's going to aggravate the situation also, because the person will not be able to understand what you're going through sometimes, because everyone doesn't know the emotional turmoil. Like one of my friends, I still remember when my father passed away, she was very honest with me. You know what she told me? She told me, you know, I don't know what you feel, Natasha. I cannot fathom the pain what you're feeling, because I have not gone through it. And I really resonated with that answer, because she was being so honest. Because till you don't go through that pain and that challenge, you will not know what the other person is going through. You know, it's very rare that people will really know what you're going through. So I really resonated with that answer of hers. And she's like, and she has parents, and she's also not married. Okay, there are so many girls who are unmarried and my age, so many who are divorced, so many girls who are married and they are not happy. So and you know, when you do spirituality, you don't know what is your soul journey. Like I was told by my spiritual teacher, you knew your mom will die at 7. You will and it's always you choose your parents. Your parents don't choose you. So I still remember telling my teacher, I think I would have lost it. Why would I choose something like that? She's like, no, because it's only when you go through that much pain will you grow in life. You know, you will come out of your comfort level. And in fact, let me tell you, I think I told Mohan uncles also that today is my dad's death anniversary. But does it show on my face?
Wonderful.
No, because, you know, because by being sad, I don't want my dad's soul to be sad. And, you know, there's a saying, when someone dies, they don't cry for the other person. You know, human beings are very selfish. They cry what's going to happen to them after the person dies. You know, they're like, oh, what's going to happen to me? I'm going to be alone. But that person's soul journey is over. That person has to do contribute. How much that person had to contribute. And that person is gone. So I feel, and you see, the spiritual masters will always say, celebrate death. So that the soul goes to the higher level. And wherever that the soul goes to the next life, the soul has to be happy. So I can't, and touch wood, my father, I still choose him because he was the most awesome father. He meant the world to me. In fact, getting up, I had to see his face. I never used to see boys outside Bombay because I was like, then I won't be able to see my father.
Anybody else any questions for her? Very well put.
So it's like it's okay, and it's not that I didn't see. I saw a lot of boys in arranged marriage, but you know, sometimes you find out the person is not nice. So I feel, I think you're saved rather than getting into something which can lead to a turmoil later.
Are there any other questions for Natasha? Okay, can I request Ashwin to propose a vote of thanks, please?
Yes,